Hello and welcome to another evening of Frank Conversation here on Hard Copy, coming to you from our studios in Abuja. I'm Maope Ogun Yusuf. A little over a week ago, the Catholic Bishop of Sokoto Diocese, Matthew Hassan Kuka, spoke in an address to the U.S. Congress Foreign Affairs Committee, addressing them on the Nigerian situation of religious freedoms. Although he did say that he was speaking for the Christian faith, particularly the Catholic faith, to which he belongs, certain parts of the speech did speak for other denominations and other faiths. That speech has generated some reaction from no less than presidential quarters, where one of the spokesperson of the president has accused him of sowing seeds of discord and division. However, there's also been some support too for the speech coming from some Catholic bishops and the Christian Association of Nigeria. All of this, the speech and reactions, speak to a management of our religious diversity, how the managers are faring, and how the managed perceive the management. It also speaks to the issue of religious tolerance. These are the topics we threw up for discussion tonight. And our guest is Majid Dahiru, a columnist and a technical team member at the Lux Terra Leadership Foundation. Majid Dahiru, welcome to Hard Copy.
Thank you very much and good evening.
Well, we are a very religious people, and at no time do we see this than at religious festivities where, you know, we celebrate with one another. We also tend to think about our faith, so to speak. But in recent times, issues of religion have become quite touchy. And I don't know if you this has been in your own experience as well. Why do you think the space for tolerance has continued to shrink and that of misunderstanding seems to be expanding?
It's because religion in Nigeria has been weaponized as a useful political tool for mobilization of people in order to attain political power or domination. And unfortunately, in the 61 years of our independence as a nation, religion has become a major tool of division, and Nigeria has become a competition ground between the two dominant religious groups in Nigeria, Christianity and Islam, with each group hardening its own grounds in the struggle for Nigeria's internal resources. This unresolved issue of religious intolerance, lack of accommodation, as would have been expected of a united nation state such as Nigeria. And this is at the core of some of the problems we are facing today in terms of insecurity, corruption and economic dislocation.
It's a very complex issue. I mean, and quite complicated as well. There are those who have said, oh, we need to divorce religion from the state. The state should not have any religion. Nigeria is a secular state. And every now and again, you keep hearing that particular statement. But in our own experience, I mean, some people will say it is two people of these different religions that will operate the secular state. Are you seeing any differentiation between the state and the religions that the many religions that Nigerians profess?
Sadly, that is not the case with Nigeria. Nigeria, yes, is a secular state, is a constitutional democracy. But unfortunately, we've seen an interloping of religion in state affairs, either directly or indirectly. In fact, we've seen introduction of religious laws in some states across the country. We've seen some political leaders, including governors, declare their states as a religious state, even without accompanying with any legislation or religious laws. But we've seen this, you know, politicization of religion across board, and it's a cause for concern because it's a major drawback towards national integration, towards national unity, cohesion, and a purposeful agenda for Nigeria's prosperity and socioeconomic development. At the core of this problem is the subjective interpretation of faith by empire builders, both in ancient times and modern times, to actually advance their political and economic gains, worldly gains for that matter, using religion as a legitimate tool. You know, man by nature is obsessed by religion, is obsessed by faith, by the unknown. You know, the world is transient. We live in a transient world, and we tend to be more concerned about what happens to us in the afterlife. And so this has created a potency for religion, which provides that answer. And so sometimes we submit ourselves to the dictates of religion because of our salvation in the more everlasting life after the current life. There's a clear distinction, but unfortunately, the embellishment of empire builders in the matters of faith have become mainstreamed in religious affairs. And modern-day empire builders, our politicians, have found it very useful to now continue that trajectory of using religion to covet their own political territories, to create divisions of we versus them within an otherwise united nation. And so you have a national identity dissonance arising from religious differences that ought not to be there in the first place. And in the issue of separating religion and state, it becomes difficult because religion is a very powerful tool. Those that are operating a secular state bow to the dictates of religion.
There are those who say, well, it is the same constitution which allowed for this Sharia faith by including it also within the constitution. Somehow we have deviated from what the ideals were. I mean, when the founders of Nigeria, the early fathers of the country, we have deviated somewhat from it. Your experience, your growing up experience, the fact that you went to a Christian school, and somehow, you know, still were able to have your Islamic religion in another school in the same community where you were. I do not know if that is still the experience of many young people who are growing up in the community in which you grew up today. Is that the experience?
It is still the experience because usually most of us attended missionary schools because these were the early schools in my community. I come from a place called Okene in Kogi State. And so we attended missionary schools, whereas there were also government schools, but the missionary schools offered, you know, more quality education. And so some of our parents who wanted to give us the best actually sent us to these schools. And while studying in these schools, we were not mandated to become Christians. There was no attempt to convert us to Christianity. We were allowed to observe our faith and remain Muslims. And usually when we close from school after lunch, we go to the nearby madrasa and study Islamic religious knowledge. Since the 70s, with the birth of Salafi Islam in Nigeria, the doctrine of Salafi Islam, does not make a clear distinction between the state and the religion, and does not actually separate citizenship obligation and religious obligation. There has been a muddling up of what, as a citizen, you are supposed to do, your duty and loyalty to the state, and your loyalty to your nation state. This is the unfortunate situation we find ourselves. It is this religious extremism that actually birthed the Sharia movement in Nigeria in the 90s, which politicians took advantage of when we transited from military to civil democratic rule in 1999 to birth the Fourth Republic. A lot of these politicians campaigned and sought for power using religion as a tool to say, look, I'm going to impose in our respective states this much desired Islamic theocracy. And so we've seen from that point, you know, a rollback on the freedoms, the unity, the convivial relationship between people of all faiths in Nigeria. When we were growing up, it has been almost eroded. In fact, it was the Sharia movement of the 90s and the implementation of Sharia laws in this state of northern Nigeria that actually served as a precursor for the Boko Haram insurgency as seen today. Now, the Salafi doctrine of Islamic theocracy, without which a Muslim's faith, a Muslim's religion is incomplete, is responsible for what you see today in the Northeast and some parts of this country, where people are now trying to forcefully pull down the Nigerian state in order to erect an Islamic or a Muslim theocracy, because it has been preached, the ideals of an Islamic state, a Sharia-governed Islamic state, has been preached unchecked for more than half a century, beginning from the early 70s. And that has eroded, or has progressively eroded, even in the most resilient states of even the Southwest, for example. We're beginning to see a religious hardening of ground, even in the mainstream.
Well, I don't know if you were able to go through that speech delivered by Bishop Coker to the U.S. Congress. There are parts of it that made reference to that Salafist doctrine which you spoke of. I mean, he was speaking in reference to recent, also in reference to the security challenges that Nigeria is currently confronting. No doubt it has compounded and even made even more complex an already difficult situation. I'll ask you much later what you think that political leaders who have these issues in their state and are a little at sea as to how to address issues of tolerance, especially with institutions that have to, institutions of state that has to cater to everybody. You know, for instance, schools, you know, need to deal with some of these issues that are cropping up. That will be one kettle of fish. The other will be how it is that these conversations that ought to be happening, even with, you know, amongst, let me quickly quote from what Bishop Cook has said now. I know that a part of what he said has already been criticized. But he said, it's important to restate that even though the purveyors of terrorism, banditry, kidnapping, and murderers of our people continue to appeal to Islam as their source of inspiration, what we're dealing with is the jihadist Salafist supremacist strain of the faith that is at best a cancer that threatens the Muslims who do not believe what they themselves believe. He was saying Muslims in northern states have suffered disproportionately in our conflict in Nigeria. And that is a truth. If we're to look at the, you know, the population of those who have suffered mostly from this crisis. Now, there are those who now perceive it to be a problem for the Muslims. Oh, it's a Muslim problem. Within the context of Islam and those who are adherents of the faith, are these conversations happening?
What Bishop Gow was trying to explain is what I've just paraphrased. These people purport to be acting in the name of Islam, but that is not the reflection of the true Islam. But again, it is a responsibility of members of the Muslim community to stop living in denial of this cancer, this cancerous strain of religious extremism that has infected mainstream Muslim theology to such an extent that we are now rolling out a whole generation of radicalized youth that are willing to die in the jihad to install a Muslim theocracy over Nigeria. What Boko Haram is actually doing today is a war of secession by substitution. They want to substitute Nigeria's secular constitutional democracy with an Islamic theocracy, because for them is a religious duty. But somebody preached this ideal as a religious duty. It is still being preached today in all major centers of Islamic learning. And this is the challenge that Muslims must not take up. Because as the Reverend gentleman pointed out, this same strain is as debilitating to Muslims as it is to non-Muslims, because fundamentally, people in this category do not consider other Muslims as true Muslims. And so they are fair game in this bloodletting orgy. And so we need to pay attention now and begin to reform Muslim theology, the mainstream. The ideology of Boko Haram is not a deviant ideology, unfortunately. It is in the mainstream. And I'll give you an example. A state like Kano today has become the poster boy of a theocracy within a secular constitutional democracy. Each time the state government of Kano purports to want to implement Sharia laws or apply sanctions for people that are violating Sharia law, they are violating the rights of citizens of Nigeria who reside in Kano, who are not Muslims. This in itself is driving radicalization, is driving extremism. So in essence, the Kano state government that we speak today, another Sharia implementing states in Nigeria, actually in the same league with Boko Haram insurgents, ideologically. Jihadi groups that are purporting to want to install or implement Sharia law often get divided along the way and begin to fight over them, between themselves over the actual and the proper definition of the concept they want to implement. Mm. And so it's a broken egg that cannot actually be put back together once it starts.
I want to ask you of this, because those who also believe, I mean, you have said that the Constitution does not hinder you from doing certain things, and it even allows. But then this big question of the hijab in the secular state, how do you think it should be addressed?
It's a very sensitive issue, because over the years, hijab has become a symbol of the Muslim faith. Whether or not hijab originally was supposed to be so is something that is still subject to a lot of controversy. But it has also been weaponized. It has become an identity without which a Muslim woman is not going to complete. As far as I'm concerned, public schools should be neutral when it comes to uniform. Publicly funded schools. Because if you want to allow everybody to actually come to school with the symbol of their religion, it defeats the purpose of a uniform education for citizens of this country. You see, we need to begin to reconcile the faith and citizenship of our people so that they can be true and patriotic Nigerians, so that their allegiance and loyalty will be to the Nigerian citizenship, to the Nigerian nation, and away from any global, you know, religious movement. Otherwise, the Boko Haram insurgency will not be solved anytime soon. Now, for me, in the case of missionary schools or schools that have missionary heritage, these are Christian schools funded by Christianity. I would think that anybody who is going to a missionary school, who willingly subjects or submits their children to the education in missionary schools, should simply abide by the rules of these schools. And if for any reason you want your child to adorn the hijab, it can only be achieved by dialogue. If in Nigeria we had dismantled all forms of religious dominance, even mere symbolisms, I'm sure that controversy wouldn't have been as much as it was. But like I said, schools are supposed to be uniform. It is an avenue for integration. It is an avenue for people to come together and advance their Nigerian identity. So I do not subscribe to identity dissonance in the school environment. This might sound controversial, but I think sometimes we begin to focus. We should be focused on the real issues and not issues that distract us and create division. So for missionary schools, it's a thing of dialogue. And I'm sure with the right approach, I'm sure they might just consider it, but it shouldn't be imposed.
Are we seeing more and more attempts at that dialogue? And would you say, well, maybe the question should be, because in recent times we have seen a proliferation, so to speak, of bodies encouraging dialogue. But these dialogues, are they yielding fruit fast enough? And are we seeing an attempt, at least on the part of the state, to recognize what the problems are and to also seek active solutions to address these problems?
Well, we've not seen much of such efforts because the operators of the state today appear or delude themselves, really, that they are benefiting from this system. But in the long run, if you look at experience of other countries, you realize that nobody's going to benefit from this system in the long run. And in fact, we are all going to be losers because if the trend continues, this trend of intolerance and religious extremism continues in Nigeria, Nigeria might yield to the pressure of armed extremist groups that actually, God forbid, take over the country. It happened in Sudan. It's about to happen in Afghanistan and some other countries. Today, Afghanistan is about to fall to the Taliban. And the reason is simple. The ideology driving Taliban is very much alive in the heart and minds of the Afghanistan people, despite over 2 decades of American collaboration. And so as soon as Americans are leaving, people have turned their loyalty away from that state of Afghanistan that America created, back to the pressure, to the opium of the Taliban promise of a theocracy that is going to solve all problems. It's like a utopia of some sort. And so it is the same thing with Nigeria. Nigeria has the same religious environment with Afghanistan. And so if we do not tackle it now while we still have the time, if the state does not come in to regulate religious practices and preachings, which I've advocated for severally, in order to bring it in conformity with the laws of Nigeria, if the Nigerian state does not discourage, punish, and sanction purveyors of religious Islam or political Islam or any form of religious encroachment upon the state affairs, if we do not actively discourage it, we're going to be losers at the end of the day. It would appear as though that the Muslim faith is, quote unquote, more complex when it comes to extremism than the Christian faith in Nigeria. It is simply because, whereas the Christian faith makes a clear distinction in all of its doctrines between the state and religion, unfortunately, mainstream Muslim theology, not the Islamic faith, Muslim theology in Nigeria does not make that distinction between the state and religion. In fact, there is no difference. Religion is the state, and religion should dictate the pace at which the state operates. And unfortunately, while we may not have achieved, for those who are trying to pervade, a full Islamic theocracy in Nigeria, people in power of authority that belong to this religion and have this same mindset appear to be momentarily implementing religious dominance through marginalization of people of other faiths, through nepotism, through sectionalism, through the elevation of people of their own faith over and above others.
I'm sure that the presidency will disagree with you on that. I'm sure you saw the response of Mr. Garba Shehu, presidential spokesperson, to that speech delivered by Bishop Kuka. I don't know, what did you make of it?
Each time the presidency reacts to Bishop Kuka, they actually end up proving him very right. Their rejection of whatever he has said on him and his message, attack the messenger, and of course, shred up the message, tells you that maybe he actually struck a chord each time he makes such statements. There's something in their consciousness that tells them that this person is unnerving us. And I'm saying, Nigeria is better off a united country where there is fairness, where there is equity, where there is no marginalization, where there is no elevation of one section or region over and above the other. Nigeria is better that way. In fact, an ideal Islamic state is one that is just and fair, is one that allows everybody equal access to opportunities, that allows everybody equal access to patronage, that allows people of various faith to cohabit peacefully without one dominating the other. That is the ideal Islamic state. So if you ask me, the ideal Islamic state is one that is secular, that is democratic, that is multicultural, that is plural, where equity, fairness, and justice reign. And so, rather than take Bishop Kuka's homilies and sermons as antagonistic, we should rather take a cue, a message, the inner message of what he's saying, and begin to evolve a more egalitarian society where everybody have a sense of belonging. And each time they attack him, they fail to note that he speaks for a constituency. The largest Christian denomination in Nigeria is the Catholic Church. And each time he speaks, they come out to say, look, we are behind him. He's speaking for us. So each time you attack Machi Kuka in the same manner you have attacked him, you are attacking the Catholic denomination in Nigeria. You are rejecting the concern of one of the largest religious denominations in Nigeria. That in itself actually goes a long way to prove the bishop right that, okay, we are marginalized. Rather than take the message and leave out the messenger. In any case, the messenger has been consistent about such messages all his life. 2 days or so after Bishop Kuka made his latest statement, killer herdsmen operating out of Zamfara shot down an alpha jet of the Nigerian Air Force. And you know, in his homily, he actually made the point that the government does not seem to be doing enough to rein in the murderous activities of killer herdsmen. And this has thrown up the question of religion and ethnicity. If you look at the figures from the presidency, from the inner caucus of the presidency, to the heads of the judiciary, to the heads of the legislature, and to the head of the executive, yes, Christians can be right to say there's a disproportionate number of Muslims as against Christians. Whether this is unintentional or deliberate or whatever, when such concerns are raised, 2 things should happen. You should address the concerns by saying, well, it is not intentional, and you take deliberate steps to balance it. It is important, rather than shouting down voices of dissent.
Majid Dahiru, thank you for coming on Hard Copy tonight.
Thank you very much for having me.
Well, that's our program tonight, but not before I leave you with the words of Pope Francis, quoted copiously in Bishop Kuka's speech. He said, "Let us dream, then, as a single human family, as fellow travelers sharing the same flesh, as children of the same earth, which is our common home, each of us bringing the richness of his or our beliefs and convictions, each of us with his or our own voice, brothers and sisters all." Now, if this is at the back of our dealings in matters pertaining to religion and faith, maybe we'll make even more progress. Thank you for watching tonight. I'm Mal Kwelekwe Yusuf. Good night.